And then we are live. Well, good morning to you all. If you don't mind, I will do it in English because we have also some foreign participants. So I hope everybody is okay with that. So thank you for joining this event. The purpose of today's event is to basically explore the challenges that might be in the segment, and more specifically in relation to steering and controlling the ship. I would like to learn more about your operational challenges and also how you look at applying alternatives and add or any technology to improve such. The idea is discussing and discovering how we can add value to your operation and make them better, safer and more predictable. And just to give you a hint, as also the title gives a bit away, is that how long has our industry been attached to the wheelhouse for steering the ship? And how do you look at steering the ship from outside the wheelhouse, from the cargo, for instance, to have a better view of what's happening without having to rely on other people with their own interpretation of the situation and or steering the ship from another ship or location? In line of sight possible. So talking about this subject, I hope to explore some of your opportunities and chances herewith. And we at Sea Machines, we get excited from customers using our technology in a way we would not have guessed. So today I have found Peter de Smet of Van Wijngaarden willing to tell us a bit more about this and how that fits in their operation. So Peter, can you briefly describe what Van Wijngaarden does and how you look at adding technology to improve your operations and how that adds value to your operation?
Yes, thank you, Frank. Well, my name is Peter de Smet. I'm the operations director at Van Wijngaarden. Van Wijngaarden is, as you always say, simply involved in rental of ships with crew. So we supply a service to our customers where we deliver a vessel with a crew, and they are dealing with workboats, tugboats, multicats. That's what we're involved in. What is the activity they are performing? Well, there's a big variety in what we are doing. You have dredging support where you're handling all type of floating lines, sinker lines, connecting to the hoppers, mobilization of equipment in dredging activities. There is stowage. There is anchor handling support on cable layers or the windmill parks, windmill farms. That's the variety of activities that we see. I see we have some other people coming from the same industry and branch that are involved here as well. I see Bert Ruiter of ACTA, and I see Erwin van Dodewaard van Herman Senior is involved here as well. So we can, I think we can share thoughts here to what it can bring to our industry. I've been discussing and asking people inside our company how they look at this at this type of solution. And what I see, it's a bit what you are saying, Frank. It's not so long ago that we were still having, we needed a steering wheel in our hands to control the vessel. And that's about the same feeling that we have right now. We say, yeah, I can walk outside with this thing on my belly, but how do I make sure that it still controls the vessel the moment that I need it? Because we all have these examples where you, at a certain moment, you put your telegraph in reverse or forward, and it isn't not working. It's not doing at that very specific moment what is needed. And then you need an emergency. You have an emergency situation where you immediately have to break in, and how you're going to deal with that. So I feel and I sense some reluctance to adapt this this type of working method.
Yeah. Okay. Of course, that's I guess that's a good valid point. And as you say, I think it's always when you talk about changes in general, I guess that you need to adapt to it and need to to understand it. So yeah, interested to the opinions of the others on this subject. Bert, do you have anything to add? Or how do you look at this?
Yeah, well, we use remotes on different equipment like cranes. And well, with the current, let's say, standard of technology, I'm not specifically sharing Peter's concern about the remotes not acting like required, but we are a ship owner that are mainly working at sea. I could see a good opportunity for using this type of technology in inland shipping when pushing barges and with tugs alongside barges and things like that. For our operations, I don't really see the added value of remote control because there's no particular situations where the master has no overview or has an opportunity at all, let's say, to leave his conning position. So I don't really see the need for it for Acta Marine. Although, as I mentioned, I could imagine other niches, other markets where it can come in very very helpful and very handy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks for sharing that, Bert. Any other people on the call that have an opinion on this or experience with this? Erwin, do you want to share something about, maybe I should explain a bit better that together with Herman Senior, we are doing a pilot project, adding an SM200 system, remote helm command system to their Shoalbuster Teddy. And Erwin, you can share a bit of your, let's say, possibilities or things that you want to solve by adding this remote control.
Yeah, can you guys hear me? Because I just switched place. Yeah, okay, good. Well, as you mentioned, Frank, we are in the trial version. The vessel, the equipment has not been installed as so far. Also a big delay due to COVID-related items. I also do not share actually the opinion from Peter. As we are having a trial with this system, I think it's a bit hard for me to say we're not interested in the system, but not for the purposes for being a remote controlled vessel. That is something I actually agree with Bert. The autonomous vessels from our type, I do not foresee a future as so far, actually not at all in the future, but our vessels are multi-purpose, and you know Frank as well because we met due to this conversation, I think. Mm-hmm. We used to have a remote control already on board, but this was not certified by Bureau Veritas or any other class bureau. So, and this was kind of illegal what we did. We did it by a box which was connected through a cable, and this was basically used for standing on the roof in case we wanted to push barges or look over barges where we don't have any access to. And I foresee some work for this type of work. It won't be the whole year round, but as I said, our vessels are multi-purpose, so we want to utilize them to the maximum possible. And I think this system provides a bit of that service.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the flexibility and okay, thanks for adding such. I'm also wondering, looking at things that you also talked about, Peter, when we spoke earlier, is that, for instance, you are also dragging pipelines or towing pipelines, if I say that correctly. How do you see that maybe also, for instance, in, you know, using a collaborative autonomy in that, meaning that you can use two vessels from which one is only manned and the other one is then being manned, while then you have, of course, double the capacity and half of the of the costs. Is that something that that might be interesting or can improve your operations?
To start off with, you always need to dream. You need to dream of something that might be possible in the future. It doesn't say that it will be working or it is possible at this very moment. But if you look at the development, because I've been following the development on autonomous vessels in the discussions in LISA, and it makes you think and said, okay, what would be, where do you see maybe opportunities for the future? If you look at long towages of, for instance, a spread of pipelines that you are towing, the first feeling that I always get, I need something to guard it, to support it when whenever you're crossing the you're crossing the seas and there's a lot of vessels around you. You want something to support it and to be around it. That could be, I think, easily done with an autonomous vessel that is sailing along with your standard vessel. It's keeping the same course, the same distance, and it stays close to your pipelines, and it makes very well make them very well visible. But in the same time, you could discuss or think about if you connect it to the backside of your pipelines, could it help you in maneuvering it in certain situations? And I think to have a good view from the front vessel on what's happening on the backside, that would be an issue. But you could say that could be dealt with cameras. Or but you could think of, is there a way that you could control it from one vessel and have the other one controlled? But of course, it is again, it's a long distance between the first vessel and the backside because it's depends on the towing cable length and the length of your pipelines, etc.
Yeah,
I had a dream.
Exactly. And what kind of distances are you talking about? Just to have an approximate.
Could be a couple of hundred meters.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. But at least in line of sight.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Could be in. An interesting thing. Another thing that we also talked about, Peter, just throwing in some balls here, but you know that if you have your plow vessel, I must say, then of course that needs to be followed by a survey vessel to see what has happened and what you have done so far. Could that also be an option where you say, okay, then again, that can be in collaborative autonomy in that sense. So then the vessel will follow the mother vessel, instead of having an additional crew on that vessel. What is your opinion and the rest?
All depends, of course, on the local circumstances, but I could imagine that dredging companies, when you're plowing right now, you need first for plowing, then you have another vessel to cross and to see, to bring it back, to have a look what is actually the situation after, before and after plowing. How easily would it be if you have a vessel directly following you? The question is, of course, can this survey equipment actually sense the bottom if it's still whirling around and the plowing is still fresh? I don't know. I'm not an expert in survey equipment, but I could imagine if you have a plow vessel that follows your vessel on an exact distance, that you immediately have an overview of the result of your plowing activity.
Mm-hmm.
It should be possible to, if you have really remote operated vessels, to have this vessel operating after like an hour or 2 hours after the plowing, right? Following you doesn't mean that there has to be a real line of sight, or it has to be like 50 meters behind you. But it can also be 1 hour later that it's passing that same track, I would say. And then there is still the opportunity to operate that vessel from the mother vessel that's doing the plowing.
Correct.
But is that really still something that you are dreaming of, or is it something that is already there?
I don't know whether it's there. It's not that what we are doing. If you look at the number of people that you actually work with on board of a vessel, controlling both vessels with from one stand will have for sure its difficulties. Before you know, they have a collision between each other, controlled from the same bridge.
I know that we're trialing at the moment, sea trialing in Australia and up in Scotland, Aberdeen area, with remote operated vessels. And what we see is that we basically operate them still from a mother vessel. But that's mainly to save the vessel or to pick it up after operations, because we at the same time we monitor from remote, so monitor from operation centers on shore, and that is where you can in a way save people on board and taking into account the size of the Van Wijngaarden vessels. I don't think that you would like to opt to have 10 people on board continuously during those operations.
No.
I think it's just a matter of years, maybe even less, maybe months before operations like this are going to be in a way everyday business. As Fugo, we are not far away from that, at least. Let me put it that way. I see that the number of remote operated vessels is increasing even more rapid than we are than we ever expected. I think that at this moment we have 5 sailing and another order is about to be issued for the 6th one.
And for which type of activities are they actually being used?
Shallow water survey, but also speeding up any survey due to basically all the vessels are wave pincher models, so you can sail them longer, you can sail them in shallower water, and they are in a way also green because they have they're battery driven. So that's another add-on or another plus that fits into the Fugro philosophy of being green, though we tend to be in the water. So that is what we do. I mean, do seismic surveys with those vessels. Of course, no drilling and sampling, Peter. That would be difficult. But it's just seismic and survey jobs. But there's a lot of interest, and there's also I even think that from Australia there's a lot of push and motivation from government to do it like this.
And what's the size of such a vessel?
12 meter. So we have a Fugro design, the fast vessels, but we also sailing the SeaKit models. And the SeaKit is just a commercial provider, supplier. And we put an unbelievably big load of equipment in it and make sure that there's connection by VSAT or 4G. Some of them, or on some vessels, we try to have a point-to-point radio link to the mother vessel. So that depends a bit on the type of equipment. Not every vessel can have this point to multi-point connectivity, so then we really have to be very careful with where we put the operation center and how much delay we have in the line. But we see trialing it looks as if we encountered the first issues, but the vessel operation is reasonably okay, so it's looking promising. Yeah. So maybe we should have another 12 meter vessel later, just to follow all our plowing vessels the day after or something like that.
I think that there will be, or in the future, you make it containerized. You can ship it everywhere, and if you can control it from your work boat, it could save time. It could save time in when you have immediate data available on the result of your activities before.
Well, 12 meter is to be containerized. You need a reasonable container, but still. But I can also think of if you are plowing on riverbeds, you can do with even smaller vessels. Because then you I don't think you need all that sophisticated hydrographical survey equipment on board. It's perhaps a bit easier, and then also the amount of data that you want to transfer from that vessel is more limited. And then with a simple connection, you can do an awful lot already. In means of control, but also in means of data exchange.
Yeah. Interesting. You said that you face some challenges already with this type of control. Is that something that you want to share, or?
No, I don't want to share. But I'll give you a little insight. Now, what the main challenges is the at this moment the keeping that the connection alive to the vessel.
Mm-hmm.
When it's on a radio link to a mother vessel, then it's quite simple. That link is not too big, but fast enough to control the vessel. But what we as Fugo want to do is also to operate remotely based on video streams. And those video streams, that is where we encounter real technical issues with regards to latency and with regards to jitter on the link. So you need to have, I would almost say you need to have either a dedicated VSAT link on a kind of, but then it starts to be technical, SCPC type of connection, because that in general creates less jitter and less latency. Or you need to go for low Earth orbit satellites, or you can work with 4G connections. However, 4G connections are a bit more difficult to route. Then the control of where your traffic is going is a bit wobbly, because you will be connecting to different masts, different cell towers. But that's where we see challenges. And with regards to VSAT, we also see challenges, but that's due to the nature of the vessel design with blockage. I'm not sure if many of you have a bit of an idea of the SeaKit vessel design, but just think of it as a sailing yacht of 12 meters with a mast. And you put the antenna just right behind the mast. So in this case, if you're sailing southerly direction on the North Sea, you have issues with your antenna looking into the mast instead of just next to the mast. And then there's no connection. And if there's no connection, well, then you just have to pray that the vessel is intelligent enough to change course in time and that you can pick up the link again.
Yeah,
or just the home button
very fast. That's also an option, but that's not really a healthy business model.
Yeah. Okay.
Sorry to interrupt, but here on the VSAT connection, is that not up to the satellite network to give you a certain redundancy that you have multiple satellites covering all angles?
Yes, that's true. But you will see that you will always get in a situation where both or all three of your satellites that you would like to use are not directly within range, and one of the main issues is that if you change beams, there is a little time involved with that. And that time is basically of the essence when you're in full operation. When you're towing from A to B, 5 minutes offline is basically nothing, because then you just look at the vessel that is behind you and that you are towing. But when you do seismic operations and 5 minutes of data is missing, or the 5 minutes of video stream is missing, then that's a risk that we as Figo don't want to take.
Okay. You're also dependent on the service provider who provides the VSAT airtime, because some providers have indeed redundant satellite beams available. Some of them only have a single one, so yeah, and you're really dependent on that one available satellite beam.
So that is something that we have been issuing. But another big challenge is heat generation inside those vessels. You need industrial grade equipment, because temperature goes up to 60, 65, 70 degrees. Not all equipment likes that. And then another option is, the more equipment you add, the more power you need. And the more equipment, the less space for batteries. So it's always a trade-off. It's always a trade-off.
Yeah, I can imagine. A bit off topic, but just to add something to that, as you say, the major operation is remote controlled, meaning that basically you have somebody sitting behind a joystick, just to put it simple, sailing the vessel, which requires then, let's say, real-time video footage, because otherwise you're lost. If you add, let's say, a level of autonomy to that, then you could reduce that amount of video, let's say, because then the vessel can make its own decisions based on collision avoidance or what have you. And then you can also reduce, let's say, the amount of video footage that is required. But
I agree, Frank, but emphasize that you are looking for UXOs, unexploded objects, and you miss 5 minutes, and 2 months later there's a fishing vessel picking up some unexploded objects that always tend to explode once on board. So you don't want to miss that 5 minutes of survey visuals that you would have. So and there's difference between sailing that vessel and giving it autonomous intelligence, and make their own decisions on whether it goes starboard or and the job that you need to do. Because if but they come up with a port where there is 20% of the data missing in the flowing results, then his customer will tell him, well, it's a nice report, but I'm not willing to pay anything for it, because you did not do your job, at least just only for 80%.
Mm-hmm. And normally, if I understand right, Arjun.
Sorry?
If you miss 5 minutes, you miss 5 minutes of the survey, or only 5 minutes of the direct connection with the vessel, because I think it's a big difference between missing the connection to a vessel, which you are not able to operate the vessel autonomously or from a distance, or not collecting the survey data the vessel is going over, because I assume there's a big black box in the vessel which still records the data it goes over.
That's in case of survey information, that's different. But also, some of our jobs are related to visual inspection of the seabed, and then you want to have an immediate view, because if you have to review after an hour or after 2 hours, then you'll see that your vessel, and also your mother vessel who does the cleanup or the in-depth inspection, is already miles away from where your object has been located. So there is always, in a way, when you do video controlled operations, there's always the need to have these live video captures. But I agree, all of the survey data is recorded and stored and forwarded to shore.
Yeah, thanks. Good good point, Evan. Thank you. Thanks, Eugen, for explaining this further in detail. Not to deviate too much from the topic, although it's super interesting, of course. But looking at remote control as one of our solutions provided, if I look at the, for instance, the poll that we have set out, then 40% of the reply was that there was an advantage seen in long tows, and approximately the same saw an advantage adding remote control, controlling the vessel from outside the wheelhouse, basically with infrastructure support tasks. And then 20% was harbor tow service. Does anybody recognize something out of this? For instance, infrastructure support task is something that we have thought about, you know, talking also to Peter de Smet at Van Wijngaarden. They do also a lot of transport back and forward from construction materials, you know, what have you, stones to build a dam or even parts for building bridges. I could imagine that then you have constantly basically a barge with materials and a vessel manned, if you can transport, of course, still that stuff to from A to B, but then leave it at some point and then remote control it under the crane, for instance. You know, is that something that is recognizable for you guys, or where you see a benefit?
You mean controlling the controlling the barge itself?
Yeah, of course. That's a good question, I guess, because yeah, I understand that if you control the barge, then it has to have thrusters, of course. But yeah, I don't know. It was just an open question because, as said, you know, 40% on the poll responded to seeing a benefit in that. Not sure if any of the audience responded to that poll in that sense. But I'm interested to see, where do you see the operational benefit and such?
Most of the time, you see that tugboats are involved because the barge itself doesn't have the propulsion. They can't. They don't put machinery in there. It's just a barge. That's what it is, and that's why you need a tugboat to actually bring it in position, bring it in place. And that's where, in that type of support, it's a bit what Herman Sidier is actually wants to do is to get a better view on your activity, what you're doing. If you can stand on the roof of your tugboat, you have a better view what is happening behind it. Controlling another vessel from your tugboat itself, I don't see the benefit there yet. It's because most of these things, they don't have the option the propulsion, maybe a split upper barge, and they are manned with few people. But controlling all these from a central vessel, I don't think so. If I look at the way it's operating or working right now, is that those people on tugboats, they're quite busy with controlling their own boat and the barge they're handling themselves. So they won't have the time to control other vessels around it as well, unless you put additional people on it. But that's where you lose the benefit, because then if you think about saving, you don't need the people on board anymore. You can put the same people on another boat, but they're still there. So the benefit would not be there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
May I say something on that?
Please.
I could see one potential benefit. Some of the dredging barges, some of the back actors, they have thrusters for moving around in port areas. But for sea voyages, they're usually towed. There could be a potential small benefit in there if you would be able to operate or to control the thrusters on the barge from a tugboat when entering a port for bunkers or upon arrival without any crew on the barge yet. But I think the potential advantage would be very limited, and it would be limited to maybe a few opportunities per year at most, unless of course you're moving these barges along the coast all the time.
Mm-hmm. I think that's where a little bit the issue with the type of industry where you're working in is the activity so different from one project to another, that you can think of one idea where it makes worthwhile to make the investment, but before you know it will be on the shelf for another year because you won't be doing those type of activities anymore. It's pretty project related, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. And thinking along further with the whole dredging, as Bert described, I can also imagine, but again, I'm not an expert in that field, but if you have barges that are filled with sand, for instance, and you need to move them to a dumping location, is that also a potential opportunity? Assuming that they are also proposed, of course. Is there anybody that has an opinion or idea about that? No?
That might be a possibility, I would say, but it's then I think you will be bouncing against legislation in different kind of countries. I think autonomously it's very young still. It's similar to other opportunities. There's no legislation for yet so far, so a lot of ports will probably for now at least will stay a bit away from it because there is not a firm track record yet of systems and of legislation around it. Mm-hmm. Also, these type of barges are still most of the time, if they are self-propelled, they are pilot compulsory, which makes it quite difficult to move it around without any people, only a pilot on board.
You can rent a pilot and say, hey, here's the vessel, please deal with it. Je best druk in je eentje.
Yeah. Okay.
No, for now, as I mentioned, we're using it for pure purpose to have a better, as Peter mentioned, to have a better overview on the vessel itself, which I think has in most of the situations where we work with barges has a big advantage. But as I said, for our type of vessels, autonomously, it's far away, maybe not in a few decades perhaps, because there's always people having to disconnect to connect wise. It's labor intensive job, although as Ogen performed for survey vessels, I do see a big opportunity for this kind of machines.
Yeah, I think it's good to add maybe to the discussion that, you know, we see it also as a split opportunity here. Huh? We have the remote control option. There, where if you can control the vessel anywhere around the vessel, meaning that, yeah, for instance, if you have a barge on the hip, or you can control the vessel, maneuver the vessel from outside the wheelhouse. But also when you are working with loads, cranes, what have you, or winches on the back, then you also have the opportunity to work from there, controlling the vessel instead of from the wheelhouse, and then rely on communication with people on deck, for instance. That's one solution. The other one is the autonomous part, and autonomous in our view doesn't necessarily mean unmanned. It can be an additional safety layer that you provide, basically how should I say, transform the human task, especially in durations or what have you, to the computer instead. I would say a bit of a split in this. I agree that maybe in certain segments, and as mentioned earlier, with Bart is connected and these kind of things, that might be a better opportunity to work outside the wheelhouse, controlling the vessel remote with the belt back, basically.
Huh? I think I have a nasty question there. If you put a computer on board and the computer is actually taking control of your ship, doesn't it look like what we have been doing over the last couple of years with dynamic positioning? And if you look at what you need as an operator to interfere and to take over, there's a lot of training, education, and before you know, you have a high-skilled person on board that really will cost you three times, four times what you normally pay for a standard operator. So is then actually what is then there the benefit to deal with that? Where is the because if you want to make the investment, what is the added value?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think
in that direction.
Yeah, well, thinking to or let's say to try to answer your question, I think the way we approach it, it is way less complex than on DP. Let's say, so it doesn't require that kind of training and so on. So there we have also the investment is much lower than the whole DP thing. And then seeing, you know, where, and I agree, it applies to certain areas where it can be added value. For instance, we touched already on the survey part, which we already have been proven that there is an added value for such. The return on investment is pretty fast on that. If you look at other fields of deployment, for instance, a crew transfer vessel, it's a bit different in the sense that you're not actually taking people off the vessel, but you just provide an additional safety layer to that vessel. We see, unfortunately, a lot of accidents happening due to people getting fatigued, they are distracted, what have you, especially in those long transits, let's say, where we are humans are not very capable to do such, you know, because we get tired, we get distracted, we what have you. And letting that do by a computer, it's way more capable to do that. It's getting never distracted or fatigued or what have you. So then of course, yeah, sure, then you still have the people on board. But if you then look at your safety, for instance, having less accidents is already also a benefit in that. Not only that, but also relieving the captain, for instance, taking on more or other jobs or tasks that he need to do otherwise after his shift. So it's really broad in the sense how you can look at autonomy in that sense. But I guess that's an interesting topic maybe to discuss further as well. I'm not sure if I answered a bit of your question, Peter, but...
Maybe I can add something, because I'm a long time driving Tesla, and it's autonomous car for more or less. And as I see what I can do with the Tesla autonomous, then it's mainly on the highways that I can do my email or telephone calls, and while the car is driving. And when there is something happening, you get a warning and you will be alerted for things, something is coming up. And that's, I think, the same way as Frank described for a captain or another people on board. I'm not working on board, I'm not experienced in that, but I can imagine that could be some added value.
Yeah.
So you are the Tesla driver with his phone in his hands on the highway.
No,
what I deserve.
There's no need to have it in my hand.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're just watching the screen.
I'm just working, having my computer on my on the steering wheel and doing my email.
Yeah, you know, it's thanks for the ad, Dick. But yeah, you know, let's not make any mystery around it. It's something, and we are running out of time, so I will close this up. But the thing is, yeah, you see this in all kind of industry. You know, the airplanes are landing and taking off using the computer. It's standard. You know, we all step in that airplane very safely, and nobody basically cares about that fact. Cars is the same. Warehousing is another one. So you see this type of optimization coming in anywhere, and we see and guess this will happen sooner than we think, also in the maritime industry. You know, moving that human task more into an automated part, not necessarily again taking people off immediately. That's not the intent, the goal, but just to move the whole maritime industry to the 21st century, I would say, in that sense. Anyway, I would like to close this because we have 45 minutes set for this meeting. Unless anybody else would like to add something.
Well, I maybe that's another topic we can discuss during one of these famous Maritime 24 sessions, Frank. That will be there anytime soon now, I'm convinced. Can artificial intelligence also be the connection between a survey team plotting a route and the sailing crew, making sure that the route that is plotted can also be sailed? Because sometimes I see a plotting route that makes U-turns in like 10 seconds and within 30 meters. And I can tell you, we as Figo do not have any vessel who can that kind of turn.
No, I agree.
And then also take into account all the surroundings.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that is where I see a lot of our sailing crew has his worries about the fact that other people are plotting the route for the vessel, and they're not in control, and there's nothing that controls that plotted route except from the officer on watch, basically.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, of course I can answer that, but to start with, but I think it's an interesting topic anyway. So maybe we can set something up to discuss this more, Eugen. I'm more than happy to.
Sure.
Absolutely. Okay. Okay. Then I will, and of course, especially Peter, to make this possible. Let's. I will share in the LISA community the link to the recording, so then you can play it back as you want. On the 19th of March, I will be hosting another event, which is then based on crew transfer vessels. So if you would like to join, then please do so. And otherwise, would like to see you, your comments or feedback in the group, and hope you enjoyed this.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Frank.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Frank.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Frank. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.